This Thursday is Thanksgiving. It's going to be a day when many of us will gather together with family and friends to eat turkey, stuffing, mashed potatoes, and pumpkin pie. We'll enjoy one another's company, and we'll also watch the Philadelphia Eagles crush the Detroit Lions. In all seriousness, Thanksgiving is a cultural holiday where we are to give thanks for everything that we have been blessed with. I believe it will be helpful for us to look at Thanksgiving and prayer in the Bible. So today we're going to look at a passage from the Apostle Paul that will model how we can thank God for other believers, how we can pray for their spiritual growth, and how we can praise God for the work of Jesus Christ. So if you're not there already, please turn your Bibles to Colossians chapter 1, verses 1 through 14. If you'd like to use the red Bible and the seat back in front of you, it's on pages 621 going into 622. And once you're there, Colossians chapter 1, if you are able, I'd ask you to stand in honor of the reading of God's word and follow along as I read our passage for this morning, Colossians chapter 1, verses 1 through 14. Verse 1, Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to the saints and faithful brothers in Christ at Colossae, grace to you and peace from God our Father. We always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, when we pray for you, since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love that you have for all the saints, because of the hope laid up for you in heaven. Of this you have heard before in the word of truth, the gospel, which has come to you, as indeed in the whole world it is bearing fruit and growing, as it also does among you, since the day you heard it and understood the grace of God in truth. Just as you learned it from Epaphras, our beloved fellow servant, he is a faithful minister of Christ on your behalf and has made known to us your love in the Spirit. And so from the day we heard, we have not ceased to pray for you, asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so as to walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him, bearing fruit in every good work, and increasing in the knowledge of God. May you be strengthened with all power according to his glorious might, for all endurance and patience with joy, giving thanks to the Father, who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. He has delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. Let us pray. God, thank you for the opportunity and privilege to come before you in worship through song, worship through the reading and preaching of your word. God, thank you for everything that you do for us. I pray our focus today will be on you and your presence. In the words of John the Baptist, may you increase and may we decrease. May what we say here today lead us to thank you for what you are doing in the lives of our brothers and sisters in Christ. May your word lead us to pray that our brothers and sisters will know you more and more. And may this passage guide us to praise you for what your Son has done for us. It's in his name that I pray. Amen. You may be seated. Let's take a moment to briefly consider where we are in Scripture. We are in the letter or epistle to the Colossians. And this was most likely written by the Apostle Paul sometime around the year AD 62 while he was in prison in Rome. And if we look at our passage, verse 1 tells us that Paul's protege, Timothy, assisted him in writing the letter, although most scholars assume that Paul was the primary author. It says, Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother. And this letter was to a church in the city of Colossae, which is located in modern-day Turkey. And what's very interesting about this city is that there's no record of Paul ever having actually gone there. We don't have a record of that. But based on verses 5 through 8 in our passage, It seems that Paul met a Colossian, a man named Epaphras, and helped lead him to faith in Jesus Christ. And then Epaphras then went back to his hometown and started a church in Colossae. As we'll see in our passage, this was a very strong, loving church. But just before Paul wrote this letter, they'd started to tolerate, allow some false views about who Jesus Christ is in their church body. And so Paul wrote on behalf of Epaphras to encourage the Colossians and to point them to the sufficiency, the reliability of Jesus Christ. In these first two verses of the book, Paul is giving a traditional letter opening. Unlike our letters that we write that begin with a greeting and then the recipient will say something like, "Dear John" or "Dear Susan," first century letters began with the sender followed by the one receiving the letter and then a greeting. So Paul begins with his name, Paul, and he notes that he is an apostle, a messenger of Jesus Christ, not by his own choice or power, but according to God's will and the Lord's authority. And after he introduces Timothy, Paul then notes who this letter is for. He says, to the saints and faithful brothers and sisters in Christ at Colossae. He is writing to those who have been called out and separated by God for his purposes. And to them he extends his traditional greeting of grace and peace from their only true source, from God himself. Now I'm talking about this because this greeting that we read is very bad news if you're here this morning and do not have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Because Paul's words in this letter, the words that we'll talk about and that I'll talk about this morning, are for those who are saints. They are for those who believe in Jesus Christ alone for salvation. They are for those who have responded to the truth of Christ in repentance and faith. If you do not truly know the Lord, all of these blessings and praises are not for you. And the reason I'm telling you this up front is first as a warning. Because if the blessings and praises I'm about to share are for Christians, if you do not know the Lord, then the opposite of them is for you. Believers in Christ can be thankful for love and hope, but you have nothing to look forward to but wrath and judgment. But this message this morning is also an encouragement and a challenge to you, non-Christian, because you do not have to stay in your lost condition. My prayer is that Paul's words would lead you to repent, to turn from your sin and turn to Jesus Christ in faith. Then these words of these passage will be for you too. Well, now let's look at what Paul says. Let's look first at Paul's thanksgiving for the church. Paul's thanksgiving for the church. I'm going to read verses 3 through 8. He says, "We always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, when we pray for you, since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love that you have for all the saints, because of the hope laid up for you in heaven. Of this you have heard before in the word of truth, the gospel, which has come to you, as indeed in the whole world it is bearing fruit and growing, as it also does among you, since the day you heard it and understood the grace of God in truth, just as you learned it from Epaphras, our beloved fellow servant. He is a faithful minister of Christ on your behalf and has made known to us your love in the Spirit." In this passage, we see that Paul was truly grateful for what he saw in the Colossians. He doesn't always include statements of thanksgiving at the beginning of his letters. For example, the letters to the Galatians and 2 Corinthians leave these statements out. So that means that Paul really truly means what he says about the Colossians. And note that his thankfulness is not directed toward them. He's not saying, "Thank you for doing this." His thankfulness is directed toward God. It says, "We always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, when we pray for you." Paul knew that everything praiseworthy that the Colossians were doing, or that any person does, could only be attributed to God. Every time he prayed for the Colossians, Paul thanked God for them. And he was particularly thankful that the Colossians had a genuine, secure faith that was resting not on their works, but on Jesus Christ. It was centered on him. It says, we always thank God when we pray for you, since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus. And also, Paul had heard about their love for others, faith in Christ Jesus, and of the love that you have for all the saints. And this love is a necessary effect of the gospel, because true faith in Jesus transforms us. It cleanses us from selfishness and develops love, concern, and compassion for others. And when we show that love and concern, we are simply reflecting Christ's love in us. But while followers of Jesus Christ are to love everyone they come in contact with, they are particularly instructed, and here Paul praises them for loving their fellow brothers and sisters in the faith. Unlike churches that were characterized by cliques and divisiveness, it seems that the Colossians genuinely cared for those in their church body. How did they do this? What did this love look like? Well, I like Pastor John MacArthur's description of love. He says, true biblical love is so much more than an emotion. It is a sacrificial service to others because they have need. We show godly love to someone when we sacrifice ourselves to meet that person's needs. Through tangible actions, the Colossians willingly sacrificed for one another, so much so that Paul heard about what they were doing all the way in Rome. I pray that our church is characterized by the same love that rises from our hope in heaven. Look at verse 5. This love for all the saints is because of the hope laid up for you in heaven. Of this you have heard before in the word of truth, the gospel. This hope of heaven is not an action, it's an object. It's a confident assurance in the reality of eternal life after we die. And this hope is laid up and stored for believers in heaven. No one can take it away from us. This hope is ours when we hear and respond to the gospel. The Apostle Peter described this hope this way. He says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you. Although it may not feel like it in the here and now, the reality of heaven, of eternity with our Lord, is just as much ours in this moment as it will be when we receive it. For believers, the future is guaranteed. There are no other conditions that need to be met. All our true hopes and desires will be fulfilled there in the presence of God. And Paul brings this up to emphasize the effect that this realization has and what it had for the Colossians. Because those who have this hope are willing to love. They are willing to forsake present comforts for future glories and give their all to serving their Lord. As British pastor Charles Spurgeon says about this passage, the man who has this hope in him goes about his work with vigor, for the joy of the Lord is his strength. He fights against temptation with ardor, for the hope of the next world repels the fiery darts of the adversary. He can labor without present reward, for he looks for a reward in the world to come. And friends, this means that the phrase too heavenly minded for any earthly good, that phrase is essentially misleading and false, because those who are truly heavenly minded will overflow with earthly good. As it did for the Colossians, the love of heaven will produce love for others. But on the other hand, someone who claims to love and who claims to hope in heaven but does not care for those around them, reveals their selfishness and that they have neither understood Jesus and they have not understood the nature of eternity spent with him. And that leads right into verse 6, words that are particularly relevant for believers today. It talks about the gospel has come to you, as indeed in the whole world it is bearing fruit and growing, as it also does among you since the day you heard it and understood the grace of God in truth. Now I know due to cultural and society changes in our country, it's easy for us to assume that Christianity is failing and it is shrinking. But my friends, that simply is not true. Paul's words reveal, and studying around the world reveals, that faith in Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord continues to expand and grow. Every day, more and more people come to faith in Him. And the faith grows not because there are charismatic speakers, or they use some new methods, or there's some advancement in technology, but it spreads because the message of the gospel is true. And this simple message changes lives. I hope you read the missionary stories that we put every week in the church prayer guide, and that you listen attentively when missionaries come to our church and they speak to us about how the gospel of Jesus Christ is changing lives across the world. This should encourage us not only to support them, but also encourage us in our efforts to share the good news, the gospel, with those around us. The church universal, all who come to faith in Jesus Christ, continues to grow. We are commanded to be a part of that growth. In the book of Revelation, we read that in the end, there will be a great multitude that no one could number, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes, with palm branches in their hands, and crying out in a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." There are people who know Him from all nations, tribes, peoples, and languages. Therefore, we are called to make disciples of Jesus Christ, knowing that our success, or rather Christ's success, is certain. This is the truth, the only truth that genuinely changes hearts and lives. For the Colossians, this salvation came as God used Epaphras. This says, "Just as you learned it from Epaphras, our beloved fellow servant, he is a faithful minister of Christ on your behalf." And then in verse 8, the man who led them to faith can now point to their display of love in the Spirit, of Spirit-filled, spiritual love. Epaphras tells Paul, "He has made known to us your love in the Spirit." This spiritual love has an internal root. It's not based on the actions of others, but on the work of Jesus imparted to our hearts. If we know Him, He will cause us to love others. And if you claim to love Him but do not love others, you ought to question the nature of your relationship with Him. Brothers and sisters, Paul's words here to the Colossians should challenge us. If I may ask, do you praise God for the growth you see in other believers in your family and in your church? Are you thankful for what God is doing and has done through the people of this church, through East Shore Baptist Church? If you're thinking about next week, the prayer service, and you're already wondering, what on earth are we going to thank and praise God for 40 to 45 minutes? Then I'd urge you to really think about your church family. I hope you read the ministry spotlight in the bulletin each week, and that you pay attention to what is going on in the ministries of this church. I pray that you are so concerned for your brothers and sisters in Christ that you can see when they are growing in their faith. And if you're still uncertain about what to praise God for, let me give you some examples to help you out. I am thankful for the lay leaders we have here at East Shore who are passionate about God and His Word. They have faced the choice between what is right and what is easy and have decided to follow God rather than man. I'm thankful for those here at East Shore who are like me and who encourage one another in the faith and with the Word. And I am thankful for those here at East Shore who are different from me, who testify to the reality that we are many members in one body. I'm thankful for those here at our church who are retired from full-time employment, but not from serving our Lord. I am thankful that they are not wasting their time off with temporary pleasures, but are using their retirement to find new, exciting, and sacrificial avenues for serving others in the name of Jesus Christ. And I'm also thankful for those who work full-time jobs and for those who are raising children and yet are still here ready to serve, learn, worship, and grow every time the doors are open. I'm thankful for families here that serve and worship the Lord together. And I'm thankful for individuals who have no family or other support other than this church body and yet are committed to East Shore Baptist Church. I'm thankful for older believers in Jesus who encourage younger believers, give of their time and abilities, and practice making disciples. And I'm thankful for younger believers who I see moving from selfishness to Christ-centered concern and compassion for others. I'm thankful for all the ministries that we have in and through East Shore and for everyone who serves in them. I'm thankful for those who already do so much, yet are still willing to help out another ministry and are willing to help out other believers in their time of need. I'm thankful for home fellowship group host families and leaders who open up their homes to discuss and apply God's word. I'm thankful for Sunday school, Wednesday night, and all other teachers here at East Shore who pour countless hours into preparing God-honoring, Christ-exalting, and biblically faithful lessons for all people. I'm thankful every time I read the evangelism notes section in our bulletin, and I get to see how my brothers and sisters in Christ are boldly sharing their faith. I'm thankful for those here at East Shore who intentionally take the time to engage believers one-on-one, to hold them accountable before the Lord, and to make disciples by teaching what Christ has commanded. These are the people who learn from someone who's ahead of them, encourage someone who's about the same place they are, and see someone behind them and seek to help them grow in their faith. I'm thankful for the countless acts of mercy and compassion shown by my brothers and sisters in Christ, especially those acts of mercy and compassion that neither I nor anyone else sees, notices, or thanks them for, but that will someday be revealed when our Lord returns. And lastly, I'm thankful for a congregation that is faithful in financially supporting our church, so that we do not have to worry about getting out of debt, but can instead focus on glorifying our Lord. When I think about East Shore Baptist Church, those are just a few of the things that I am thankful for. What about you? I pray that you'll express your thankfulness in prayer next Sunday. And if you have not done so in a while, take the time to think and to praise God for what He is doing in the lives of others in your church family. And I pray that you'll come next week and share your prayers of thanksgiving and praise with all of us. But as for Paul, he is thankful for what God has done in the lives of the Colossians, but still he prays for their continual growth. He has a prayer for the church, Paul's prayer for the church. Let me read verses 9 through 11. And so, from the day we heard what he just talked about their faith and their love, since the day we heard of that, we have not ceased to pray for you, asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will, in all spiritual wisdom and understanding. Why? So as to walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to Him, bearing fruit in every good work, and increasing in the knowledge of God. May you be strengthened with all power, according to His glorious might, for all endurance and patience with joy. Friends, we never finish our spiritual growth this side of eternity. So like Paul, we should pray for our brothers and sisters in Christ to grow in their relationship with Him. And what should we pray for exactly? Well, let's look at what Paul does. First, he prays that the Colossians would be filled or completely controlled by the knowledge and understanding of God's will. This is not a prayer that God would somehow supernaturally reveal His hidden desires and decrees, but that the Colossians would come to grasp the truth of God's word as revealed in the Bible. As the Protestant reformer John Calvin wrote, His will is not to be sought anywhere else than in His word. This will of God is his plan to redeem peoples from all nations, a plan he uses his people, his church, by his Spirit to accomplish. However, Paul's prayer is not only that the Colossians would know God's will as revealed in Scripture, but that believers would understand and apply it. He asks that they may be filled with the knowledge of his will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding. And Paul prayed something similar for the church of Ephesus in Ephesians 1, 16 and 17. He says, I do not cease to give thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him. Paul is then going to expand on this principle in verse 10, where he says, the reason you have this knowledge is so as to walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him, bearing fruit in every good work, and increasing in the knowledge of God. God's people are to walk worthy before him, because anything we do that is not to please God is pointless and useless in the grand scheme of eternity. Therefore, we should remove those things in our lives that oppose God and instead live with a desire to worship and honor him by obeying his word. With this prayer, Paul is simply echoing the words of Psalm 1, 1 and 2, where he writes, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. Such a life will produce a holy attitude, godly living, and lost sinners won to faith in Jesus Christ. Paul is here praying for nothing less than the Colossians' spiritual growth. And my friends, we are called to do the same. I'm encouraging you to not just pray for your brothers and sisters in Christ when they are sick or in need, but regularly, if not daily, pray that they are growing and maturing in their faith. Pray that they are becoming more and more like Jesus Christ. Now, before Paul moves on to a final expression of thanksgiving, he prays for the Colossians to be strengthened by God's power. In verse 11, he says, may you be strengthened with all power according to his glorious might for all endurance and patience with joy. Note that the apostle places God as the source of spiritual power here. It's not a ritual, not a sacrifice, not our behavior, but God himself is the source. It is his glorious might. And this power gives believers endurance to withstand trials and temptations, and patience in dealing with and loving others. And friends, this request would have been just as countercultural in Paul's day as it is in our own day. In the Greco-Roman world, most people sought to be protected from evil spirits and to receive wealth and influence by serving a wide variety of gods and holding to a vast array of superstitions. Today, many people view spiritual power as something that's hidden inside, that you have to dig deep and become your true self in order to access. If God is included in that equation at all, he gives power only in response to my works. If I say a particular prayer, or if I behave a certain way, that forces God to make me into the me that I want to be. But friends, all of these God substitutes rob our Lord of his proper glory. We receive power not for our own desires, but so that we grow in Christ, persevere in the faith, resist temptation, know the joy of the Lord, and fulfill his will. We will not be strong without God's help. We need his power to live for him each and every day. Every time you serve the Lord, every time you successfully resist temptation and sin, it is not because you are special or because you found some strength within you. It is because God has enabled you. He has given you the power to live for and to please him. And since he is the one who gives power, when he saves us by his Holy Spirit, we can endure, we can be patient with joy, trusting him rather than our own efforts. May we pray for our brothers and sisters in Christ to know God through His Word, to apply it to their lives by obeying and pleasing Him, and to joyfully endure struggles and suffering by His power. And this brings us to Paul's last point. He returns to the subject of thanksgiving in verses 12 through 13, 14. But this time, the thanksgiving is not for the church, it is for Jesus. Listen to verses 12 through 14. He says, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. He has delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of His beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. Why does Paul come back to thanksgiving here at the end of this passage? Because as we grow in our appreciation for what the Lord has done, as we know the gospel of Jesus Christ better, then we become more like our Lord. The more we know about God and what He has done for us, and the more that knowledge becomes thankfulness in our lives, the less likely we are to sin and to stray from Him. If we were to continue to read Colossians, we would see that the Colossians had been a little confused about who Christ actually is and what He has done. So here in the very opening of his letter, Paul is calling on the Colossian believers to remember who Jesus is and to thank Him for what He has done. As John Calvin explains, there is nothing that Satan so much endeavors to accomplish as to bring on mist with the view of obscuring Christ. Because he, Satan, knows that by this means the way is opened for every kind of falsehood. This, therefore, is the only means of retaining as well as restoring pure doctrine, a right understanding of God, to place Christ before our view such as He is with all His blessings, that His excellence may be truly perceived. This morning, we have talked about many things that we should be thankful for. But what Christians should be most thankful for is the person and work of Jesus Christ. And in these three verses, Paul is going to explore just a small portion of what Jesus has done for those who know Him. First, he tells us in verse 12 that God has qualified us to receive an inheritance. He says, giving thanks to the Father, who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints of light. We have been empowered, made fit, made sufficient to receive the blessings of eternal life. Now, while it's not exactly what's going on here, it might be helpful to think about a job application. Typically on a job application, they'll have qualifications for the job that you want to apply for. They might say things like, must have a 4-year degree, must have 3 to 5 years experience, must be able to work weekends. Well, the qualifications for God's inheritance are must be a child of God, must be a member of His kingdom, and must be 100% perfectly righteous and good. And the sad truth is that on our own, none of us in this room meets those qualifications, because we are born enemies of God. We are citizens of the domain of darkness. If we were truly honest, we are so far from 100% goodness that we would fail even with the most generous teacher's curve. And anything less than 100% righteousness is unrighteousness, is wickedness in God's sight. But this is exactly why Paul tells the Colossians to give thanks. Because God did not look for the qualifications for the inheritance in us, but in the person of His Son, Jesus Christ. Jesus was perfectly righteous, and by His perfect substitute sacrifice on the cross, we receive His righteousness, His goodness. We are adopted into God's family. We become citizens of the kingdom of heaven, and we are accepted by Him. We become part of the kingdom of life. We are not perfect because we still struggle with sin, but He accepts us. Now, as a part of His family, we receive the inheritance of God Himself. The best part of the gospel is not that our sins are forgiven. It's not that we get to go to heaven. It's that we get God. We get a relationship with Him. In addition, Jesus has delivered, rescued, snatched us away from the domain of darkness and sin. Verses 13 and 14, he has delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. Everything opposed to God was in that domain of darkness. We might look at someone who we know is not a Christian or not a believer, and we may think, you know, they do some pretty good things. But God only sees selfishness, wickedness, and rebellion against him. If we do not know him, everything we do is an offense to him. We cannot help but sin. But Jesus makes us qualified for heaven. He makes us ready. He makes us a new creation because he has moved us, he's immigrated us, he's transferred us into the kingdom of spiritual light, the domain of Jesus Christ. We are in a new kingdom, a new country, and we have a new citizenship. And how is this possible? Verse 14 tells us, because in Jesus we have redemption, we have deliverance, we have liberation and forgiveness from sin. Just as a slave is set free, a criminal is released, or a prisoner of war is liberated, those who come to know Jesus Christ are freed from the damaging bondage and eternal suffering of sin, of rebellion against God. We have been purchased out of the slave market of sin, and we have been adopted into the family of God. The work of Christ alone restored our relationship with God. We did not bring this redemption about. This salvation is on the basis of God's choice. He decided to save us. As he says in Ephesians 1, 7 and 8, in him, in Jesus, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight. The blessings are only available in him, in Jesus. Friends, we can take none of the credit for our salvation, absolutely none. If your testimony, the story about how you came to faith in Jesus Christ, is more about you than it is about Jesus, then you really do not understand what Jesus has done for you. But what is Paul's teaching, though? What does it mean for our lives? It means that everything Christians say, think, or do is to be a grateful response for what Jesus has done for us. Brothers and sisters, it should revolutionize your daily behavior to think about everything you do as a direct response to Christ's work on your behalf. You should always ask yourself these questions. Is what I'm doing, is what I'm saying, and what I'm thinking right now, is this appropriate in light of what Jesus has done and is doing for me? Is my behavior right now consistent with that of my Lord, with that of Jesus? And if the answer to any of those questions is no, then don't do that thing, plain and simple. If we would just center our lives on the cross, on the person and work of Jesus Christ, we would be radically changed for God's glory. Christian living is not about a do's and don'ts, should do this, should not do that. It's about focusing on him and your life being changed as a result. Every part of your life change, including our prayers. So as for Thursday and for next Sunday, I hope that the truths of this passage inspire you to praise God for what he has done for you in salvation. I pray that the prayers we offer over the course of this week will be expressions of thanksgiving for the person and work of Jesus Christ. Not only on Thanksgiving or in a prayer service, but every day, believers in Jesus are called to rejoice in the blessings of salvation, the blessings of qualification, inheritance, deliverance, redemption, and forgiveness. I love this quote from British pastor Charles Spurgeon. He says, it was easier for God to bring Israel out of Egypt, to split the Red Sea, to make a highway through the pathless wilderness, to drop manna from heaven, to send the whirlwind to drive out the kings. It was easier for omnipotence to do all this than to translate to move a man from the power of darkness into the kingdom of his dear Son. Friends, the more we understand this salvation, the more joyful our gratitude becomes. Every Christian has more to be thankful for than we could possibly imagine. But before we respond today in worship, I must return to a point I made at the very beginning of this message. And that is, if you do not have a relationship with Jesus Christ, then you have little to be thankful for. You cannot thank God for other believers in your church because you do not have a true church family. Or you may go to a church, but you do not have a true church family if you do not know Him. You cannot praise Him for the work of Jesus on your behalf because you are an enemy of God. But my friend, you do not have to stay that way. If you will turn from your sins and place all your trust, all your faith on Jesus Christ alone, the words of this passage will be true for you as well. You will become a part of God's church. You will be qualified to receive the inheritance. You will be delivered from the domain of darkness into Christ's kingdom, and your sins will be forgiven. If you'd like to know more about that, you can talk to me or talk to someone here who you know is a genuine Christian about how you can have a relationship with Jesus Christ. But maybe you're here and you are a true believer, but you are without a church family and you long to experience what Paul is describing about the Colossians. East Shore Baptist Church is not a perfect church, but we are passionate about God, passionate about His Son, passionate about His Spirit, and passionate about His Word. And we would love for you to join us. As for my brothers and sisters in Christ here at East Shore, my prayer is that you will have a greater awareness of what God is doing in the lives of other believers in this church, and that you will have a greater awareness of what He has done for you. And once you know that, I pray that you will thank, praise, and worship God, not only today, not only Thursday, not only next Sunday in the prayer service, but each and every day, for He alone is worthy.